Good evening. It's Maundy Thursday, and this is a celebration remembering the night in the upper room. We won't have much in the way of a liturgy tonight, but I want to talk to you and spend time focusing on what the meaning of that night with Jesus and the disciples was really all about. It is not intended to be high church theology. I'm not big on substitutionary atonement. That is that's the fancy theological term that the churches and the pastors of the churches have used for generations to talk about Jesus' death on the cross in substitution for my sins. I don't deny that that's an important part, but I think we spend too much time focusing on that and not enough on the abiding friendship and love that Jesus had, not only for the disciples, but for the people who followed him and the people who were around him and his understanding of what this night means. So if you will enter into this evening in that kind of a mindset, I think this whole thing will make a little bit more sense. In that spirit, I would remind you we are worshiping tomorrow the three church procession, beginning this year at the Lutheran end of the equation and ending at the Methodist slot. We will be here from 1:45 to 2:30 within a range, and Luke Booker is preaching. You are welcome, of course, to join us for any or all parts as you are available as you wish, but we're glad you're here tonight. From your seats, would you begin with me by singing Be Still My Soul, the first of the three hymns that you have in your printed materials.
Be still, my soul, for God is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to your God to order and provide. In every change, God faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best eternal friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul, for God will undertake to guide in future days as in the past. Your hope, your confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be clear at last. Be still, my soul, the waves and winds still know how Jesus' power ruled them so long ago. Be still, my soul, the hour will soon be here when we shall be with God whom we adore. With this appointment gone, no grief nor fear, sorrow replaced with joy forevermore. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed we shall meet at last.
On this night so long ago with Jesus and the disciples, it was the Passover Seder. A Seder is a time when the Jewish people gather and remember their own stories. They remember how it was that the Lord led them out of Egypt, how the trail that they had followed under Moses' guidance had not been easy, that the work that they had provided for the Egyptians was hard and arduous, that in the course of that meal they would remember their forebears in the family of God. And on this night, we remember the story of ourselves as the people of God through Christ. On that night, Jesus and those Jewish men who were his closest friends, with whom he had wandered across what we call the Holy Land for several years, telling stories, converting minds and hearts, healing people, offering hope, changing the understandings of what it was that God had in mind and what the rule, the law of the community of faith had said, and what God's intentions might be. It was a family reunion of sorts. But this family reunion in which Jesus is engaged is more than that. Those 12 with whom he had wandered and been so close, those 12 who had been the ones to call him to account, who were the ones on whom he first tried out most of his lessons, the ones who provided him with fodder for his preaching, the ones who thought they got what he said, but who often did not, and yet on whom he relied. These 12 gathered with him for an evening meal to remember who they were. I would presume they thought they were going to do a Passover Seder. But in the midst of all of that, Jesus was among them and asking them to do something new and to do something different. The gift of memory and the challenge of being remembered is a hard lesson to learn. What is it that comes to us after the years of life? What is it that we hope for when we are preparing for this journey to end, even when we are in our early 30s, as was the case with Jesus, knowing what was going to happen in the course of the several days ahead? What was it that he wanted seemingly more than anything else in the human context? In the human context, this table is not about substitutionary atonement, as I said before. This table is a memorial. It's a remembering. It is not about the transforming power and the grand theological arguments about what the bread stands for and means and what the cup stands for and means. It's as simple as remembering. Every time we celebrate this sacrament, every time we gather about this table, we use the words that Jesus said. Every time in that ritual that we follow when we do the communion liturgy, as often as you do this, remember me. It's a simple request. And yet, it's not an easy one to make. Nobody wants to have to look at someone they love and say, remember me. No one wants to have to leave and be remembered. None of us hopes for that moment when we look at those about whom we care and say, I don't care what comes. Just please, remember me. Remember the walking. Remember the boats. Remember the storms. Remember the stories. Remember those who begged for things. Remember those who yelled and hollered at us and told us we were wrong. Those who criticized us. Over the course of this journey, we have seen much together. And whether you know it or not, tonight the journey will end. You know the story. The disciples began to mumble amongst themselves when Jesus talked about betrayal, when he talked about what was going to happen. And Peter pipes up and says, Lord, that won't happen. What does he say to Peter? Three times, you'll deny me. Those denials are a form of forgetting. The one he loved best, seated at his right hand, gets frustrated and runs off in order to betray him. That's an act of forgetting. The others sat around the table wondering what was going on, not understanding, murmuring to each other about what Jesus was saying. So true to form, they were unable to remember what Jesus would teach them even in the moments before. It is simple. Come and eat with me. For the sake of friendship, for the sake of our being colleagues, for the sake of being fellow workers in the Lord's vineyards, for the simple fact of remembering me, come and eat. Perhaps there was hope in him that that action, that simple engagement with them would be something that was memorable to them. Certainly, institutionally, the church has remembered it. Every time churches celebrate communion, we memorialize, we remember that moment. But do we memorialize what is there beyond the church think and the church teach? Do we remember that this is a guy, one person who, though we have made much of him over the course of the years, and truly he was, we believe, the Son of God, this one who was still fully human was about to give it all up. It wasn't going to be an easy thing. It certainly wasn't going to be a happy thing. And yet he did so willingly. He was prepared to do all that God would ask, and that's again where we come into the special relationship that we have with Christ, in that Jesus was willing to endure all of this, knowing that something else would come from it than what others would have expected. We come to remember not only Jesus in the godlike form that we have worshiped in the church, but also the simple human who was willing to challenge those who were in power, who was willing to look at the smart people of the day who had all the answers and call them out for being wrong when they were too hard-headed and too unwilling to see that they had been wrong. He was asking them to remember the children they had encountered, the kids that they had seen and touched, the ones who were so excited by what he had to say. Let the children come. Don't stop them. These are the ones who will dwell in God's house. In a time and in a place where children were ignored, Jesus was willing to call them forward. In a time and a place where women had no voice, not only did he let them have voice, but he enjoyed the camaraderie that they brought in the context of the earthly ministry. They were prepared to follow wherever he would lead, and he let them do it in a time when women couldn't. Whose voices were the first ones heard on Sunday morning? As usual, what did the church do to those two women? Peter steps forward and takes their narrative and changes it to meet his needs. But Jesus wasn't about transforming the story. He was about transforming the lives of the people with whom he was journeying. He was prepared for them to do their worst, and yet he only wanted in the human way to be remembered. Nobody wants to be forgotten. How many times have I known friends and acquaintances who spend time at their old high school looking for their track record, whether it is still painted up on the wall of the field house or the gymnasium, and suddenly feeling bereft when they realize that their 30-odd-year-old high jump record has finally been broken? How many of us go back and look in places where we have been known as workers or as colleagues and wondered who's left? Does anybody even know that I'm still here? When we look at the courses and the places and the pit stops over the course of a lifetime, we wonder, do they remember us? Do our kids remember us when they are far away and we don't hear from them often enough? Are the neighbors that we used to know so well and with whom we had such fun, who are now living elsewhere, do they remember the enjoyment and the pleasure that we had? It's human. You see, on this night, I'm looking not at Jesus as the Son of God. I'm looking at Jesus as the Son of Mary. The one who was raised by Mary and Joseph, a carpenter, the guy down the lane, the one who has been wandering and telling stories, and frankly, who most of the people looked at as though he was probably a little bit off kilter. We do that, you know, with prophets. People who are willing to speak hard truths, we look at them with just a little bit of confusion and sometimes more than a little bit of scorn. And it's that little bit of scorn that comes to bear in all this, you know. You don't turn in your friends. And yet the people who were following around after Jesus in that week between Palm Sunday and Good Friday, they are the ones who turned on him and ordered the freedom of Barabbas by their screaming and their mobbing. The table was laid. The preparations had been made. The elements that were needed were present in the room, and in came the crowd, in came the boys, in came the folks to celebrate. If you've ever been to a Passover Seder, you know there's a little bit of pleasure around it and there's a little bit of dread, because it is the story you've heard how many times, again and again, how we were led out of Egypt, how we made the bricks, all of those pieces of the narrative that are so familiar, and we delight when our children hear them. But really, I've heard this one 57 times. Do I need to hear it again? Somebody get on with this so we can eat. In that moment, though, Jesus interrupted their procession from the remembering to ask them, look here. You see this bread? It's not much. It's flour and water. But it is of the dust that God gave us. It is a part of all of us. Just as we are all parted by God, we are all part of God's imprinted order in the world. God breathed into lifeless dust and brought us forth. So too the bread of communion, the bread that we use to remember, that is my body broken for you, he said. This is a gift from God. Whenever you do it, just remember me. And he took a cup filled with wine. He said, take and drink, isn't it sweet? Proof that God loves us in its sweetness. And whenever you drink it, do it for my sake. When we eat the bread, drink the cup, and gather about the table, we remember the gifts which Christ gave us. And we remember the man who was willing to go against the expectations of the world and of the day, and was willing to say, I'm here, and what you're doing is not right, and we can do better, we can do more, and we can do well, in the face of people who were unwilling to do that. Grudgingly, it seems to me, probably, the disciples agreed, came along and did. They did what Jesus asked. They remembered. Would you join me in singing the second hymn in the materials provided for you this evening? Deborah will play it through once. I'm not sure it's one we're terribly well familiar with, but if you'll do that, Deb, play it once.
My song is love unknown, my Savior's love to me, love to the loveless shown, that they might lovely be. Oh, who am I that for my sake, my God should take frail flesh and die? My God should take frail flesh and die. God left the richest throne, salvation to bestow, but Christ its flesh and bone the world refused to know. But oh, my friend, indeed, who at my need did life expend, who at my need did life expend. Sometimes they threw down palms and sweetest praises sang. Through streets and markets rang, then crucified is all their bread. Blood and death they thirst and cry, for blood and death they thirst and cry. What has my sovereign done? What makes this rage and spite? Christ gave new strength to run, restored the gift of sight. Sweet injuries, yet they at these themselves displease and against Christ rise, themselves displease and against Christ rise. I sing my plain belief, one song my heart outpours. Never was pain nor grief, never was love like yours. This is my friend in whose sweet praise I all my days could gladly spend. I all my days could gladly spend.
Blessed by your Holy Spirit, gracious God, these are gifts of bread and cup. May they remind us of the love with which Jesus loved his disciples and loves the church in this day. May they be for us symbols of Christ's body and blood, and may they be mostly for us a way of remembering not only the sacrifice, but the great love which Jesus shared with those with whom he journeyed. Send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts and on us, that we might be agents of mercy and ministry and change in a world so sorely in need of your presence. Bless all of us who will receive it, and help us to know and remember that we are yours, now and forever. Amen. The bread we break is the body of Christ. The cup we share is a sign of the new life which Christ brings. Christ our Savior is offered for us. The feast is ready. Come and remember. I invite you to come forward and take bread and take a cup. If you cannot come forward, I will bring it to you in your seats when others have come. So, if you will, Pat, come and join. Take the body and blood. us pray. Almighty God, in humility, we receive these gifts given to us. And we praise you for the gift of memory. Memory that helps us to remember those who have gone before us and those whom we love in this life. Those whose journey is drawing to a close. And those who are anticipating with great joy the coming of new life into their families and homes. Watch over us and all the church as we in this weekend remember all of the challenges and trials you endured and the promise that is fulfilled on Sunday morning when the voices of women ring out with joy, for something new and wonderful is sure to come. We bless you for the ways in which our faith buoys us up in our hours of need, and we praise you especially that in the gift that you give us, we are given the chance to see that salvation is real, that we shall be changed and the world be made better for our having lived as you have taught. And so we remember the words that you offer to us for prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you are willing and you are able, would you stand and join us in the final hymn of the evening, Day is Done. It's from the materials you were given.
But love unfailing dwells ever here. Shadows fall, but hope prevailing calms every fear. God our Maker, none forsaking, take our hearts of love's own making. Watch our sleeping, guard our waking, be always near. Dusk descends, but light unending shines through our night. You are with us, ever lending new strength to sight. One in love, your truth confessing, one in hope of heaven's blessing. May we see in love's possessing, love's endless light. Look close, but you, unsleeping, watch by our side. Death may come in love's safekeeping, still we abide. God of love, all evil quelling, sin forgiving, fear dispelling, stay with us, our hearts indwelling, thus even time.
Go forth from this place knowing that our friend Jesus is with us, asking us to remember. Remember that he is here, he is with you and within us all, changing us for the better, and that God's Spirit will guide us and guard us through the night until we meet again. Amen and amen.